Hachette Audio presents The Ark of Taste, delicious and distinctive foods that define the United States. Written by Slow Food USA, Giselle Kennedy Lord and David S. Shields. Read by Melissa Miranda. Introduction. The next time you're in a grocery store, take a walk over to the produce section and look at the tomatoes. If you're lucky, there will be a few varieties, such as beefsteak and cherry, as well as maybe the country of origin and a barcode on a plastic sticker. And that's it. That minimal data is all that's typically given about the food that nourishes our families, takes center stage during holidays, and satisfies cravings every day. But did you know that there are more than 10,000 different varieties of tomatoes in the world? Some are purple and sweet, some are green and more acidic, and others are red and yellow. They can be both misshapenly large and comically tiny. These varieties have been cultivated by humans over generations to maximize nutrients, to delight taste buds, and to thrive in a specific climate. This amazing biodiversity is a testament to a beautiful reciprocal relationship between humans and plants. Each variety tells a story of culture and history, of movement and climate. As our food system becomes more industrialized and colonized, produce like tomatoes has become a commodity with a barcode to ship across borders and ultimately land on your grocery shelf. As a result, we are losing biodiversity at an alarming rate. The Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations estimates that 75% of our global crop diversity was lost in the 20th century. And today, only 9 plant species account for 66% of total crop production. A similar story is happening with fish species and breeds of livestock. The sharp decline of food biodiversity has a huge impact on the ability of people to feed themselves, has wide-ranging and negative impacts on soil and animals, and reduces the resiliency of farms facing extreme weather from climate change. When it comes to our plate, the loss of biodiversity also means nutrient-poor options and boring flavors. Slow Food's Ark of Taste is all about the joy and justice of biodiversity. It's a global and grassroots effort to catalog the amazing range of foods around us before they disappear, and to raise awareness about how we can act together to preserve and promote these fantastic finds. The pages ahead of you are packed with delightful profiles of farmers, recipes for you to explore, and stories of delicious and distinctive foods facing extinction in the United States. Arranged by region where the food is currently produced, this book includes a whole host of tomatoes not found on your grocery store produce aisle, including the Amish Paste, Cherokee Purple, and Livingston Globe. We hope you will take this book to your local farmer's market, talk to the farmers about what varieties they grow, and perhaps try growing new varieties in your own backyard or windowsill. For Joy and Justice, Anna Mule and Mara Welton. Executive Director and Programs Director, Slow Food USA. American Chestnut. U.S. origin, or most prevalent in Appalachia. Characteristics: piquant, sweet, toothy in texture, small nut, large tree. USDA plant hardiness zones, 4 to 9. Close relatives: Asian chestnut, Sicilian chestnut. Notable producer: American Chestnut Foundation. In late September 1874, the Appalachian Ridge newspapers from Maine to Georgia published a notice that read simply, "The chestnut trees will soon be ready to be clubbed." This announcement was common before the chestnut blight of the early 20th century. Until then, one of the great autumn recreations of the region was nutting. Drumming the trunk with a hammer or beam would shake ripe nuts to the ground for collection, provided the trunk was not too broad and the tree not too tall. If one chanced upon a giant, not unusual for the robust American chestnut, a nutting party would resort to other methods of harvest, like shimmying up a trunk using a leather cinch belt. These excursions of old hold a delightful place in all reminiscences of youth, reported the Greensboro Record in 1909. Even those who do not roam the countryside to gather the fallen nuts amid the leaves welcome the less romantic appearance of the roaster and the vendor in the city streets. While the roasting of the delectable nut in the coals of the fireplace is a delight known in those homes where the fireplace survives. Sometime shortly after 1900, a fungus arrived with chestnut trees imported from Asia and spread to the American chestnut trees in the northeastern hardwood forests of the U.S. Arborists identified the blight in 1904, and to their great dismay, discovered that no remedy could counter its lethal effect on the cambium layer beneath the tree's bark that serves as a tree's hydraulic system. Blight spread steadily, first in the northern chestnut forest from Maine to Maryland, then down to the Appalachian Ridge, until the whole eastern range of the tree sickened and died. Thus, this dominant tree of the eastern uplands essentially expired in an ecological disaster that still haunts the minds of those who enforce biological security in the United States. Animal populations that had depended upon the autumnal nutfall for sustenance came under great stress. Deer and raccoons turned to the upcountry cornfields to survive. Human foodways disappeared with the tree, among them the masting of hogs in October beneath chestnut groves, the making of native chestnut breads from nut meal, the boiling and mashing of chestnuts into spoon meat, and the making of chestnut gruels and grits. To these common dishes, one could add the refined preparations of chestnut soufflés and chestnut puddings that grace the side tables of Eastern households during the holidays. These dishes were all but lost with the trees, and all that remained after the blight was the Christmas-eyed appearance of imported roasting chestnuts and perhaps a few additional nuts from the traditional stuffing or dressing. The most reputable of European strains is the Sicilian chestnut, larger and more meaty in texture, pleasantly sweet, but not so distinctive in taste as the American chestnut. Both Chinese and Japanese chestnuts are significantly less sweet and sometimes tend to be chalky in texture. All hope is not lost, though, as forest ecologists, geneticists, and scientific arborists have labored to restore the American chestnut tree to its traditional range since the mid-20th century. In the 1970s, a hypovirulent but non-lethal strain of the blight was imported from Italy, and diseased chestnut trees were inoculated in their cankers to counteract their destruction. This proved to be an effective local remedy for infestations in the Northeast. However, the most promising path forward has been the breeding of resistant hybrids of the American chestnut. Using a breeding scheme devised by Charles Burnham, blight-resistant Asian trees are crossed with American trees, and their offspring crossed again with just an American chestnut tree. The resultant trees from these bat crossings are predominantly, though not absolutely, American chestnut. The American Chestnut Foundation selected these hybrids as the instrument for the reforestation of the old eastern range. The edible portion of the American chestnut is piquant, sweet, small, and rather toothy in texture. When dried, the nut makes a versatile meal and flour. Because of its culinary quality, the American chestnut inspired an expansive set of dishes and regional foodways. Chestnut-fed pork and chestnut-fed venison stood high on the judgment of connoisseurs. Holiday turkeys were stuffed with chestnut dressing. An array of chestnut-centered delights, chestnut pudding, deviled chestnuts, chestnut soup, chestnut souffle, chestnut bread, chestnut caramels, and chestnut porridge were common and cherished dishes of the Eastern.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.